Can security catch up the volume and velocity of product development? So to have the discussion, we have Ms. Priya, Madhavan, Director, DSCI, and the panelists, Anand Pande, CISO, GSTN, Hemangini, Kappla, Vice President, Architects, CIB, JB Morgan, Nitesh, Sinha, Founder and CEO, Sacumen, Raghavendra, Bhat, Head of Security, Validation and Testing, SAP Labs. Please.
We just had a cup of coffee, and the session today is pretty exciting for all of us in the application development world and product development world. So I'm sure you're going to be hearing a lot of insights from our distinguished panelists. So the topic that we always hear, whenever we talk about a web application, every day a web application is anything but fully secure is a day when a potential data breach can happen. So on a web application, you have all the sensitive information. You have your customer data, you have your market information, you have your monetary transactions, and if a breach happens, it's a loss of reputation for your enterprise. Interestingly, Verizon in their DBIR report, I think today somebody else also mentioned the Verizon DBIR report, Verizon Data Breach Investigation Report, it's found that web application attacks are responsible for more number of breaches than any other data breach. They actually account to almost one-third of data breach. The web application data breach accounts to one-third of it. So we do have other types of web attacks, like we have the DDoS attack, which happens. But that only affects the availability of our CIA, our fundamental principle of security, confidentiality, integrity, and availability. So availability is what gets attacked with the DDoS attack. But unfortunately, with a web application attack, you have a data leak attack, which causes stride. And stride is spoofing of identity, you have tampering of data, you have repudiation, you have information disclosure, denial of service, and elevation of privileges. You would not want to be having any of the stride attack on your application. So I'm sure all of us can't agree more on how secure we need to keep our web application. So we do have our esteemed panel who are going to be sharing their ideas about how they have gone about securing their applications or their products in their workspace. So I'll start off with an introduction. I'll start off in the order that they are sitting here. So we have Hemangini. She is a vice president from JP Morgan Chase. Hema is a technology architect. In her current role, she understands business requirements and proposes optimal solution around technologies, focusing on simplification, virtualization, aggregation, and automation. All key words to make a difference. She's responsible for stacking and layering of architecture modeling and decision making in terms of technology comparison with different technology. Welcome, Hema. We have Raghavendra Bhat. Raghavendra Bhat heads the security validation and testing at SAP Labs India. Raghavendra has about 17 years of experience in software industry. He has great expertise in application security, including data privacy and protection. He has wide exposure to domains like network management, system management software, security software, CRM, web application, and DB application. Next, we have Anand. Anand is SVP, CISO. He works for GSTN. I think all our eyes and ears will go up because I'm sure all of us are cribbing about the GST tax that we need to pay for all the transactions that we make. So I'm sure his experience would be very, very useful for us to all hear. Anand Pande is an astute and accomplished leader with more than 18 years of experience in InfoSec, IT governance, risk management and compliance. He has expertise in transforming complex compliance requirements into user-friendly processes and implementing them across organization to ensure overall governance. Specific areas of interest include designing, implementation, and management of information security, IT, infra, IT security, ISMS, ITSMS, BCMS, EMS, NOC, SOC operations. So I think he has all the credentials that we would like to have in a person. IT procurement and vendor management. He has worked across different industrial sectors like BFSI, FMCG, ITIS, telecommunication, financial institution, regulators, IT software product development and technology. Welcome. So we have our fourth panelist, Nitesh Sinha. He's a founder CEO of Sacumen. He has 17 years of experience. He has worked as a security architect and has worked both in security services and product company. Nitesh is the CEO of Sacumen and he carries prominent security certifications like CISSP, CICISO, CISM, CISA, CGEIT, CCSK, and HCISSP. So welcome on board, very distinguished panelists. I'm sure we are in for a wonderful discussion. So without much ado, so the topic is, can security catch up with the volume and velocity of product development? We heard about platformization this morning, so at the click of the button, they want things to happen. So if that's going to be possible, then you need to be able to deploy your applications that much quickly and probably be able to maintain the environment that much easily. So in a scenario like this, security is always seen as a roadblock for fast development. And current age is continuous delivery. It's not just continuous integration, it's continuous delivery. Can we still roll out applications which are secure? So we're going to be talking about that over our conversation. So before we talk about the current state of continuous integration, I think it would be interesting to hear from each one of you as to how y'all are handling application security in your enterprise and how have you transformed this function from just being a security testing as an NFR. I'd like to start with Hema.
Yeah, thank you, Priya. So the topic is, can the security catch up with velocity and volume of product development? So the key part here is catching up with the speed of deployment, speed of development, and at the same time be secure. So till the time we do not integrate the security practices and the security tests that are recommended into our development practices, we would not be able to catch up with the speed of deployment into production. So for example, you would have, a scan for open source tools. And if you put a patch or if you put a tool embedded in your IDE, your developer's IDE, then even before the code is compiled, he will get an error that this particular jar that you have used is not secure and please replace it with so and so. Rather than going through the entire SDLC and just before getting into production, this person gets to know that, oh my god, the jar that I have used is kind of so insecure that I have to remove it. And by the time he would have had a lot of dependency with other tools and other jars as well. So the key is to have these security practices early on. So the keywords that we use here, the DevSecOps or whatever flavors of DevSecOps that are being used today. So yes, automate and put the security practices, embed those security practices early on. At least the static scans and the scans like open source scans, you can easily automate at the earlier stages of the development cycle, and later on you could also start embedding the DAS scans. So that is my opinion, and that is how is our approach.
Thank you, Hema. Over to you, Raghavendra.
Okay, so here again, I will answer on the same topic, that's velocity and volume. Why volume is, to give you a brief idea, the software that we have, the code base that we have is one of the largest. We have 300 million lines of code. Okay, so when we develop software of that volume, if we want to incorporate security as a practice, we have to have a very strong process. So we started with secure SDLC. So it was started as a culture itself. So we started by training one colleague from each development team. Again, that number itself was huge. Then we had all the tools in place. We had a dashboard which will make the status of security implementation transparent to board level, up to board level, including development VP, CISO's office, and everyone. So they could see the progress of security when the software was getting developed. Yeah, so we trained each one team member from each development team so that they can assist the development team in a decentralized way, or else, you know, everyone has to be dependent on the centralized team. But central team was supporting them with process, controls, tools, and so on. So we also went with CICD model for development. Apart from this, we also, to support the development team, because of the speed, if we just do security testing when the component is already developed, it will be again too late. It's like, you know, going back to waterfall model in one or other way. So what we did was that we started developing security functions. So the different security controls that are there were developed as security functions and incorporated into a framework which was given to all development teams. So that everyone, when they develop their component, they don't have to bring in, think about how to implement a particular control. They can just bring in a function that is already readily available. So we enforced it through the framework.
That's very interesting, yeah. Actually. And I think that's what we talk about these days, about security coding best practices, secure yes. coding principles. And you have actually implemented as a code itself, like a function right. where they can just say, this is what I will be putting in, rather than every time recreating the yes. code. Wonderful. Wonderful.
So it also improved the efficiency since it was delivered by the central team.
Wonderful, wonderful. Yeah, Anand, can you please share your ideas?
Yeah, thanks. So, while providing the introduction or initial setting of the context, you said that security normally is looked at as the roadblocker, and yes, it was a perception till some time back, but now with changing requirements and the time press requirements, slowly that perception is changing. I was just going through one of the reports that now inclusion of security during the entire SDLC cycle, it has helped to identify the defects early, fix or address them early, so that at least the 30% of efforts are minimized. So there are multiple reports with multiple numbers, but this is one of the report probably I'm quoting, okay? And say that has helped us also. So we are also following all the keywords, say DevSecOps, SecDevOps, and Ops, DevSec, whatever. So I always say that we are following SecDevSecOps. So we are also all those keywords are there, say CICD and all, we are also following. If you look at the from the volume perspective, probably yes, our code is also sizable and it is catching the millions and all those numbers. But at the same time, the main challenge in front of us is to deliver in very time constrained deadlines, and that mandate comes from Government of India, and normally the department name is Finance Ministry or PMO office, then you don't have any option but to deliver. So yes, no application is developed 100% perfect on day one, but yes, it should be within the acceptable limits and it should meet the intent. So without compromising the security with all these keywords and best practices, secure coding practices, so we are able to meet the expectations so far. So don't know, we are just moving the journey. Application is still under development. Changes are still flowing in. It's kind of, many times we say that it's kind of fixing an engine in a running car. So that is what we are experiencing as of now. But yes, it's a good experience. And yes, the volume is increasing, the pace is increasing, and the security requirements are also equally critical. And it's a mandate like whatever you want to do, whatever you want to deliver, security should not be compromised, because it is one of the key principles in designing the such a national critical system, which is handling very critical data, not only financial but personal data of the taxpayers. So that's it.
Yeah, thank you so much, Nitesh.
Hey, thanks, Priya. So I mean, just compared to the other panelists we have, right, I'm actually on the other side. So I'm a service, I head a service, company, right? So we provide services and specialize in working with security product company. So I'll bring the perspective on when we work with different product companies and enterprise customers, what we face, right? So first thing is, right, so when you put security as a non-functional requirement, right, I think one of the, this is term which I've always sort of puzzled me, in the sense that why people call it under non-functional requirement. I mean, given that most of the people, you know, consider security as an afterthought, by putting, when they're putting security under non-functional requirement, do they mean that they expect the security to be non-functional? I mean, it's a quite obvious thing that, you know, functional, requirements always get, much more importance, right? Why security is not a functional requirement? I think that is a question which I've always, something which I've always, thought of, but still it goes under the non-functional requirements. That's one part, right?
The reason I put it as non-functional, because most of them say, oh, security is a non-functional, but that's the fundamental difference that people need to bring in terms of what you all are saying about security, SDLC, and testing is not an afterthought. It should be right from the design, requirements.
Exactly. Right. Yeah, I think to answer your question, right, I mean, I'll relate to one experience what we had in sort of setting up a application security program for one of the large insurance company. So what we had is typical call whenever as a services company when we get, right, is, can you guys do a pen test? And I also sort of, as a security practitioner, I always scrib, you know, because the damage is already done. Now I'll always only find it out and give it to you. So I think because of the size of it, what happened was, we educated them that given your scale of it, right, why don't you think from a long-term perspective and really look to set up an application security program? So at least the CISO was very convinced. We obviously did our own selling in that way, right? And then, so what we started was to get the current state, right, where exactly they stand, we adopted, a SAM, the Software Assurance and Maturity Model. So we took that model and evaluated them. So just on the SAM side, right, they have 12 security practices across 4 business functions in terms of governance, construction, verification and operation. It's typically SDLC in that way, right? So once we evaluated them, obviously they were just covering around level 1, which is a bare minimum. Then, there are 3 levels, right? So once we presented the report to the CISO, is something he said, I was like, okay, I mean, I would definitely want to go to level 2, and how quickly I can do it? Can I do it in 3 months? And I said, no, it doesn't work like that. And I sort of gave him somewhere around a year's time. He said, no, I mean, let's target 8 months, right? So, okay, that's fine. I mean, we of course need to get business as well. So we started with what we follow as a 5-step, program. 5 steps which we follow to set up an application security program. You can find the details on my website. But what it gives is really a planned process in how you go about setting up the application security program. So it starts with the planning phase, go to the define, go to the execute phase, then you monitor and then report the results, right? So in the planning phase, what we typically do is when we are setting application security program is first thing is you set up all your security policies, you set up all the tools which you'll be using when you are doing your SAST and DST, you define your standards and framework when you are sort of, would want to use for your maturity model or your verification standard or your threat modeling, right? Have one standard which does that. And then, of course, define your security coding guidelines. So that's part of the planning phase. Then we moved on to the define phase, right? Wherein we set up the secure
SDLC process for both waterfall as well as agile model. So one of the things which I'll always recommend to people, right, is since most of the development these days is done using agile, you should look at using the Microsoft secure SDLC for agile development. It's a wonderful framework what they have given. In fact, they have given specific security practices what you should do across as a one-time activity, something like laying out a security policy or laying out an incident response process, or for example what you should be doing at a, you know, as a sprint level, right? Maybe you should be doing threat modeling as part of every sprint or as part of even every bucket, right, where you typically do a SC, DSD, right? So once we defined all of that, then we moved on to the execute phase. Now, one of the things which is always when it comes to a sort of rolling out a program, right, from the top executive is, I mean, people don't think from a developer mindset or a tester side, right? I mean, if you just define, okay, I'm at level one, I want to be in level two, right? This is what it is. And you are not even sort of educating the developers, you are not giving them the tools, you are bound to fail. You will have a lot of failures which I have seen, right? So we sort of work with their stakeholders in terms of giving them reusable library from, let's say, OAPS, SAP, you know, using ASVS standards there, right, to help them in implementing that. And then once we did that, right, is finally we sort of measured it using the SAM was one thing, ASVS from OAPS is another verification module, right? Once we measured it, we reported to the CISO, right? But just the end story was, it neither got completed in 8 months, it neither got completed in 12 months, it got completed in 17 months. So that is what it is, because you are trying to make changes to the existing application and it's already damage is done, right? So it takes time to recover. So that's one of the journey in sort of, yeah, you know, just from a security program rollout.
It's a wonderful insight that you've given about. And in fact, when we were just discussing, Hema also brought up the same thing. All these new procedures that we are telling about secure SDLC, DevSecOps is all fantastic for a new application development. So what do you do for the existing application? How do you go for, and those applications are in production. So how do you keep them safe and secure? I think all our panel here has very interesting things to share. So Hema, would you just want to be talking about that?
Right, so when the application is new and you are starting from scratch, it is relatively easy to get all these practices implemented because the team is ready, there is no code, and you start from scratch. But being an ancient organization, we have ancient projects, and that will be so with most organizations that have been around for a while. And these projects are in different states and different stages using technology which is probably end of life or nearing end of life. And then to implement these practices, the continuous integration, continuous development, it becomes a challenge. And then you always address the problem one step at a time. You do not overwhelm the team. You ask them to do a bit of it, and when they get accustomed to it, you get them to the next stage, and then you get them to the next stage. Or else it will not be successful. So it is always a phased approach, and you give sufficient time for the team so that they can reach the potential. And sometimes there is a lot of tech debt that gets built up over the years. And the decisions have to be taken whether you want to invest time to resolve this tech debt or you want to build a new application altogether, because that will be more cost effective, more easier to implement. So you have to be a little smart, and there is no one-stop shop in any product or any solution. It is always case to case, and especially in large organizations where there is a lot of different technologies, different methodologies put together, it will be case to case. Although you would have some standards, like you would use standard tools, you would have a central security team which is going to guide the journey of any application towards security, achieving security. So you would have these, and you would have invested in training your teams. Periodic reviews. You would have certifications, and all the good things you would have. But it generally boils down to case to case implementation when it comes to old or slightly aging applications.
Correct, and that's going to be the reality in any enterprise. You are going to have aged applications, and we keep typically saying, we from security professionals, when we have to say network patching and all that, we'll say, it is not in CMDB, so I'm not going to patch. The same thing applies here. I don't know what all applications are running. I'm sure most of the companies don't even know what are the applications that are there. So whether they're following security best practices is a question mark. So it's a tough game, I understand. Yeah. So just going, and it's very interesting to know that all of you all are following Secure SDLC, which is fantastic. It would be very nice to share your experiences in terms of following Secure SDLC, were you able to improve your security code quality, and were you always able to ensure that you are doing all the test gates and then rolling out your application? So all of you are running critical applications. Probably we'll start off with Anand to comment on this.
So you are asking me a very critical question in the forum, right? In the public, I cannot, I'll try to be as transparent as possible, yes. So my answer will be yes. Okay. We were able to improve the code quality and minimize the errors, but at the end of the day, say security requirements are there, business requirements are there. We need to strike a balance between both, okay, the business need and the security need. So that's somewhere we are so far able to achieve. To the expected tolerable, within the expected tolerable limits. So that's what we say. Otherwise, any imbalance would definitely create havoc. Either you will have compromise on the security front or at the delivery front. So this is where we are currently.
Anybody wants to add on that?
Yeah. For us, security requirements are kind of becoming a business requirement itself. Because with the digital transformation that we are seeing, most of our applications will talk to the social media, will have big data, will connect to IoT, and will be on cloud. So that means that everyone is connected. Customers, vendors, suppliers, employees, and our assets. So this is the time of hyper-connectivity. So if we fail on security, then we will not be in business. Yeah, so security requirements are becoming a business requirement. So it's no more an afterthought, and it is becoming one of the prime requirements now.
Wonderful. Yes.
So it's good to hear that, you know, security requirements are considered as business requirement. I think just when you talk about secure SDLC, right, I mean, for the people here, I think one of the important framework which is there, and I don't know why it has not really got the adoption which it should ideally have, because we have actually applied for our customers, is the OAPS ASVS, right, which is the Application Security Verification Standard. I mean, I'll strongly recommend when you go back, just look at that framework and go and talk to your management and say that let's do an assessment of where we stand using this framework, right? It has 19 areas of security in terms of session management, architecture, design, you name it, right? Web services, everything, right? And it has those different levels. Just assess yourself of where do you stand. And then go about that exercise of using ASVS, because what ASVS will serve is, I mean, look at the current SDLC process if you look at overall, right? The biggest problem is everyone is without target, literally, right? So every time you roll out a new version of the product, right, the thing is, does your developer even know what he needs to implement as part of the security features? Does your tester even know what exactly he has to test, and what exactly is really defines the improvement, right? When we say we are improving as a security, and your top management stops taking you seriously, they see you as an IT issue, right? And that is where if you have to, I mean, you cannot, as security practitioners, can be cribbing, okay, you know, mujhe to funding nahi milta hai. You know, my top management, they talk a lot, but they don't fund. But have you really taken efforts to talk in their language, right? I mean, in terms of talking real tangible benefits, and that is something OAPS, ASVS would help. I'm talking from my experience, right? It's something it can serve as a code checklist for your, for your developers. It can serve as a test cases for your testers as well, right? And you can even use it for your vendors. Let's say if when you're using your cloud service or any of these vendors, right? Just put it that is your application compliant to level 2 of ASVS. I mean, you'll find them running away, many of them, right? Only you'll get the best product. So that would be my recommendation, to use OAPS ASVS there.
I think that is very, very useful, very, very useful. And similar to ASVS, OAPS, ASVS, I think people can also look at Microsoft Secure SDLC. If you think you follow OWASP or your program has taken care of OWASP top 10 vulnerability, do you think your application is safe?
So I'll take that first. The reason is because I'm a service provider, right? And most of the people actually, surprisingly, when they call is, of course, pen tests. But the other part is to be compliant. Even when we are developing product for security product companies, if you're compliant with OWASP top 10, that's all we need, right? I mean, and it's like, that is just top 10. I mean, what about the remaining part, right? I think you need to look from a broader perspective, right, in terms of your nature of application. So we, most of the times when we take up those so-called pen testing engagements, we never do it without having a demo of the application, without understanding the architecture. We never even sort of give a quote wherein you will come and give us, say, okay, I have 10 APIs, two applications, can you give me a quote? I mean, if you operate like that, you ultimately he will suffer. I mean, we'll make money, but it will not serve the purpose, right? So I think, obviously, to answer the question, OWASP top 10 is a very, very limited view of that. But just to add that, take a poll across the world of how many developers are there and ask them how many people even know OWASP top 10 without giving them a time to search in Google.
Why don't we take a
don't search in Google, instant poll, do they know OWASP top 10? I mean, these are security practitioners, right? So I assume most of them would know, but this is a fact that, and that is something management needs to be sort of cognizant to, the fact that developers are trying their best. You need to give them the right tool and you need to give them the training to do that, right? You just cannot bombard them, okay, I need to be at level 2 of this. You just do whatever you can. I mean, you need to help them out, right?
Perfect. I can't agree more.
So, in any financial institution, security is not a luxury. It is necessity, otherwise code will not go into production. So if your application has vulnerabilities which are identified high critical, it will be stopped and it will affect your timelines, and all the stakeholders will be informed that the delivery will go into production at a later date when the vulnerability is fixed. So OWASP is just one aspect, one tiny aspect, but all the other tests which are absolutely critical have to be executed on the code, and only secure code can go into production or defer the release. That is nice to hear.
That you wouldn't go to production with the issues. You both want to add? Okay, great. So back to the first topic, like, be it products or projects, the development timeline is heavily crunched, and we talk about, as I said, click of the button, we have to have a feature going in. So how are organizations handling this change?
I'll take it first.
Great.
Okay. Since I started with that topic, when I said implement security functions through the framework, this is one of the approach. See, when we have crunch time, nowadays we have very short time for releases. So if the security functions are developed centrally and provided to development teams, they can just incorporate it during development time. They don't have to think about how to implement it or from where to import it. Second thing, we also, what we do is, we are working on this project called as RASP, that's Runtime Application Security Protection. So what this does is, this makes the application taint aware. So application starts observing for vulnerabilities or threats, and it does, it takes the defensive measures. Yeah, so automatically that application itself takes the defensive measures. So we are working on this. Still a lot of research is going on. So we are making a good progress of it. So this again helps.
The very valid, very, very useful information. And just want to add, there's something called as IAST also, Interactive Application Security Testing, and RAST. I think those are technologies that you could use to ensure that you're able to manage with the crunch timeline. Anybody else want to add? Okay. So one is, he said about the processes that are used to ensure that we have a quick development. And we did hear the words of DevSecOps and SecDevOps and DevSec and SecDevOps, all combinations of that. But the reality is you have to follow DevSecOps procedures to ensure that you're able to handle the agile environment and going forward the microservices environment. So if you all have implemented DevSecOps in your work earlier, it would be nice to hear about that. How did you go about doing it? Was it with the usage of tools, or it was more like the frameworks that we heard from Raghavendra? If you can share the opinion, I'm okay with whoever wants to take the question.
Okay. So we follow secure SDLC. So again, I'll go back to the process first. So when we say process, we start with a risk assessment, threat modeling. We have SAS tools, DAS tools, then security planning. That means every phase of software development, we have incorporated security, apart from the functions and centralized push. So every team has to follow it mandatorily. So that means whenever a build is committed to GitHub, from there Jenkins picks up, and when you create a build, you have to run the SAS tools, yeah, checkmarks, fortify, whatever we have available today based on the technology that we use. So everyone has to run it, and they have to say what they found and what they did for that particular vulnerability. What is the mitigation measures they have taken, whether they are fixed or they're having other mitigation measures. Then a central team will look into it and say, it's kind of auditing, and say whether it's okay or not okay. So this way, we have central approach as well as decentral approach. So having one approach may not be enough when we have a large development teams, when it's a big software company. So we have this mixed approach where we have a decentralized team looking into the SDLC during the development, and we also have a central team which does auditing and controlling from the central place. So that makes it more efficient.
I think, I don't know, right now, say with the changes and the mandates, what we have, what in which bucket it will fit or to which keyword it will fit, whatever methodology we are following. So earlier when we started the project, we started with traditional waterfall. Then that time I think the GST law rule act bill was not passed, and the rules and forms we received a couple of months back before the deadline was already set, communicated in the to the nation. So before July, a couple of months back, we received it, and then we need to make multiple changes to our approach. So we, from waterfall, we went to agile, multiple sprints, automation, multiple reviews, then CI/CD, use of tool, wherever duplication is there, identify that. So time to time with, say, requirements, and as time is passing, we are also learning through, we are on the learning curve, I'll say, and fine-tuning our approaches wherever it is required, but compromising the compliance with various standards, frameworks, and security. So in GSTN, I think I cannot put it in a single bucket that, yes, I we are following secure SDLC or DevSecOps or what. But yes, it's a kind of currently mix of many things. But ultimate objective is to, yes, have compliance with the frameworks and follow the best practices.
So I think what Anand talked about, right, I think that's what has been the evolution of the so-called DevOps as such, right? From your waterfall to agile to finally your so-called DevOps, right? But I think fundamentals don't change. I think there's too much of jargons flowing around this, especially people like us who want to sell solutions. But I think fundamentals still remains the same, right? Your secure SDLC processes, everything has to be put in order. Only two factors have really changed, right? One is the pace, the other is automation. Security tools, unfortunately, has not really caught up with the DevOps speed, right? And they are still trying to do it. I think, ideally, if my predictions are true, in sort of 2 to 3 months, a sort of unicorn company in cybersecurity will be something which takes the requirement from ASVS, right? Put it in my requirement document, automates the process wherein whenever the developer is coding, right, against that verification standard or whatever
controls you have defined, it will sort of test against this, and the moment you have put it under testing, right, it will do an automated testing against all of that and then finally get it in deployment. I think that would be the real essence of pure DevOps with security in place. Otherwise, we are still catching up, and I think for at least the leaders here, you need to be patient. We will be making mistakes. Don't have fall to the magic for the marketing guys that our DevOps solution, security solution, would solve everything. It is a learning process, as Anand says, and I have seen from my experience.
That's yeah, wonderful, wonderful takeaway from all of you. So just to add on to what the panel told about DevOps and secure DevOps, I think it's very important to, if there are some startup companies here, I'm sure they can take your idea and get the tool, whatever you said in terms of getting it from the ASVS to the requirements, and then have a tool which will have your coding, secure coding practices involved in it. So that will be fantastic if you have a tool set today. But I think there are some tool sets available. For example, White Hat have a tool called Scout or something like that, which is along with the IDE. The tool is deployed along with the IDE. And it also helps that the person who's coding understands the security false positives that come out, and he doesn't have to go to a central team, which is security application experts, to help him resolve that. So there are tools today which actually, I think, tells you where the error is and gives you a code snippet on how you can go fix it also. So that much development is there. But I don't know, I think it would be very interesting to do it from the ASVS till the final move into production. That'd be good for some of the startups if they are here to take that idea and take it forward. Coming on to the final thing, I'm sure most of us have heard serverless architecture. When I read about serverless architecture, I was just wondering, what is the serverless architecture? So I did a little bit of reading to understand what serverless architecture is all about. It is not that there is no server. It is actually, you are not responsible for the server code or the server application or the server infrastructure. You basically use a backend service, or you could use a function. So that was something that I also learned, because I was curious, what is a serverless architecture? Everybody is talking, AWS has Lambda, which is a platform. Okay, fine, so what? I didn't understand. But that is going to be the future. We talk about microservices, but very soon there will be, I think there's already adoption of utilizing serverless architecture, for example, backend services. Today, there are services for database update. There are services for authentication called Auth0. Companies are using that. So that's something which was interesting for me to know. It's not some faraway future. I don't know how many of you all attended the cryptography session yesterday of quantum cryptology, which is definitely there, but it probably may not happen in 5 years. Maybe it'll happen in 10 years. But serverless architecture is more a reality. I'm sure it's going to come. I mean, people are going to adopt it much more. So coming to that, serverless architecture, you're not responsible for the code. You don't have the entire code base. There's multiple parties here developing pieces of code. So how do you ensure that you're going to have a secure application?
So I'll just cover from a services provider perspective, right? So we are moving to a service-oriented world, right? Everything is provided as a service. So all this fancy term, serverless architecture, all of that, right? Whether it is a PaaS, FaaS, right? It's already in play, right? So, for example,
we have to tell what PaaS and BaaS is.
Okay, PaaS is backend as a service, FaaS is function as a service, right? And
so we've heard of IaaS, we've heard of PaaS, we've heard of SaaS. Now, these are the two things which
I guess, to simplify it for you, right? Always simplicity is a better stuff. It's very simple thing that for certain functionalities, you are reaching out to a third party service, get the things done, delegate it and get the things done, and you get the response, right? So it looks simpler. But I think compared to anything when it comes to a cloud security, whenever you're using any service, right, you are bound to lose control. So, and at least from my practical experience, no matter how much people would say, right, I think it all boils to that vendor agreement, what you sign with your service provider. And it should mainly contain three things. One is you need to have a right to audit clause. Right, that's one. The second part is you need to have your verification standards, like a ASVS clearly saying that if I'm buying your service, right, it needs to have this sort of level of security already in place, right? And I think the third one is in terms of I think we're discussing that time right to audit there
the agreements that they should have in terms of the application?
The SLAs, right, in terms of the response time, incident response time and all that. I think that in really consent only control you have when you're engaging any of these services companies, right? Other than that, as a security, I'm not really sure. As a practitioner, I've seen a lot of controls except for having that agreement which really controls, you know, takes care of you. I think that's from my experience there.
Anybody else want that?
One more flavor of SaaS, PaaS, FAS, or whatever AS. So for internal private clouds, companies are looking at providing these services. So Amazon and all is little far-fetched, but internally companies do provide the services, backend as a service or maybe caching as a service. So these are already in place, sometimes in production. The only problem is that they limit the choice of technology. So if Oracle is used as a backend as a service, then you are limited to only choosing Oracle. So that is one of the limitations. Otherwise, there is an adoption. But external public clouds, it's slightly, you know, a little far-fetched as far as I know.
When coming to testing of these services which are available, it becomes very important. Actually, it's we don't have that type of skill sets all the time because it's an evolving field. So every time you will come up with, you can see a new service that is offered. So here, testing becomes very critical. Unless it meets the criteria, we should not take it. We should be very strict there. So if we are introducing a vulnerability by using any of these services, that is something, you know, which cannot be handled at all. What we do in general in cloud is that we try to know as little information as possible about customers' data. So we call it as zero knowledge. That means that we ensure this is a capability to do transport, your process, store data in a complete confidential manner. Yeah, so we call it as zero knowledge. So we don't want to know about customers' data at all. We just service, transport, process the data. So even in case of a breach, infrastructure breach, so hacker will not get to hold on the data at all. So we use a lot of mechanism like tokenization, anonymization, computation using ciphertext and so on.
That was pretty useful. You want to add? Okay. So I think we've had a lot of insights from all of you. Thank you so much. So the takeaway is DevSecOps is possible. Security can definitely be there, even if you have to roll out applications, volumes of applications, and velocity. So there's no need to compromise on security if you have to roll out applications in a very agile in an extremely continuous delivery environment. So it is we don't need to compromise on security. So we could have questions opened up. If anybody have questions, we could have the panel address that. Either it was all very clear,
well
or I don't want to say, I would rather say that it's all clear.
It's all clear. Well understood.
Everyone follows so that when the code gets into production, then it's easier.
excellent question. So panel, please.
Yeah. So prioritization, it's not good to have a standard prioritization across industries. It's good if your company decides it based on the business that you are in, based on the technology that you use, how relevant it is and so on, rather than having a common standard, though there are a lot of standards available. Okay, answering to the first question, so so we do face this problem where development team says that end of your testing phase, you give us a report with so many issues, reporting so many issues, which will block the release, because if you have high priority issues open, we'll not be able to release it on that particular release date, and release date will be always somewhere close to the report dates. So what we do is that we, again, it's because of lack of awareness. So security team should not have a KPI to say that every time you do a testing, you should report so many issues. If that is the case, they will always say that I will report all these issues during end of the reporting time.
I will disagree. Testing team has to have that KPI.
So, I will come to that. So the thing is that what we do is that as soon as our team finds an issue, or high priority or low priority, whatever it is, if it's especially high priority, we immediately tell it to the development team, telling them there is a high priority issue, we saw it, a high priority issue that has been identified, you need to fix it. We don't wait till the end of the testing period to report all the issues together. That will be a burden on development team. Yeah, so as and when we find it, we'll immediately give it to development team, telling that we have this testing period, so we'll not wait to report all the issues on the last day.
Wonderful. I want to answer that from the perspective of development team. No, we do not view the reports as dangerous reports, and we do not view the security people as villains. It's in fact good that vulnerabilities are identified upfront and we know about it. But sometimes the vulnerabilities that come as critical are actually not critical, and they could be deferred till a later date. So we have to investigate. We have to put in time to investigate whether it is really critical and really high that has been identified as the report tells us. If it is, then obviously we have to fix it, because if it goes into production that way, firstly it will not be allowed, but we somehow convince and it goes into production, then it's a problem and jobs will be at stake. So people will not do that. We will analyze and we will go through all the high critical and try to resolve it, or if not, then we will try to find a solution to it.
Because yeah. All of them have real life experience with that.
No, I think I'll go back to the root stuff, right? I think you should ask your management is something, did you share the security requirements clearly, right? I mean, security is not an implied phenomenon, right? It's an explicit one. Unless you state it, you don't get it. The problem is everyone says, I want better security, but has your management really taken steps to, you know, put it in clear requirement, this is what I, from my application, this nature, this is my verification standards, and you better comply. And that's why I always keep saying is, go a step back and correct that process issue in terms of using something like a ASVS, which serves as a benchmark that I am at level one possibly, let's target level two. And we know clearly even the start of the next development cycle is, these are the things which we need to do to achieve level two. Trust me, as Emma said, right, is developers don't hate security team, but the problem is the way, you know, security team approaches that and, you know, makes them their life difficult at times, you know, that friction happens. But if you go in this matter, developers love to ensure that their code is secure. So ASVS, maturity models, I know these are fancy terms. When I was a developer, I always used to say, what is all this? But I think it makes sense, because once it starts to flow from the top, you have much more support and you'll actually get extra time. You'll not have at least sensible management, which will be like, just, you know, forget about it, just let's go and, you know, let's screw us up. I mean, if you are following a logic, it will happen. Otherwise, it's a tough journey.
Excellent.
So they have covered most of the points, right? So there is nothing, separate solution other than what they have said. But yes, I think it depends on organization to organization and its business activities to what to, it depends on their acceptable appetite also, risk appetite as well. So based on that, we can take a call. One more thing is that not, as Hema said, that not all vulnerabilities, though it is reported in the final report are critical, right? You need to work very closely and remove the false positives. That's what we also do. Our application is very bulky and any tool will throw high, critical, medium, all combinations, right? But at the end of the day, you need to go through the report, identify which is critical, what is its impact, and wherever you feel that yes, it's severity 1, severity 2, or the severity is within the acceptable limits of the organization, based on that call can be taken. So we all know, we all are following, and we have multiple similar experiences when handling the security and the development, right? So it's a practical situation, and this is what is the rational approach. As I said, that the balance between security priorities and the business priorities or the requirements, it has to strike somewhere, but at the same time that should be clearly identified, agreed, and taken forward.
I hope it answered your question. Yes.
It's not, but that's fine. So it's all we are well aware what kind of business we are into, what kind of data we are handling, though we are not the only entity if you look at it. So your personal information is available with banks, your personal information is available with income tax, right? And similar entities, UDI is a classic example where your PII and SPI is with with Aadhaar. So but yes, that we are aware the security and privacy of the data. If you look at our key principles for designing the system, it is inbuilt into that. And we have, to implement security, you should know what is your landscape, right? So identifying the information asset, what needs to be protected at what level. So there are multiple controls and multiple tools and technologies are there. But only tools will not implement, deploying some tool will not help you achieving the security, right? So the there has to be a continuous monitoring process, and that we are following. There are n number of entities, external entities also, who are auditing us. While I am talking, a team of 14 CAG auditors is sitting in my office, and it's a long-term 70-day audit. Okay, they will cover every aspect of the system. So, but with my experience, I think there are very good tools and technologies which would help us to achieve the security. The most attempt should be to have visibility, continuously increase your visibility within the your network, where the information is continuously flowing in and out, and have appropriate mechanisms to take the actions based on that intelligence or information you have. And it's a continuous process. You cannot say that yes, I have SOC sitting somewhere, NOC sitting somewhere, or I have deployed some firewall or following some standard means I am 100% secure. It's not like that. It's ever changing, and every day is different learning for me. So it's like a continuous job. I cannot say that yes, we have deployed so many layers and so many tools and technologies, it means the data is safe and secure. But yes, I can obviously say so far the data is in safe hands, and we are equally concerned for that data. And yes, I'm still in job.
I like the answer of Anand. It's a true security professional jobs answer. Till date, I'm safe. I don't know what's going to happen, which can't be any better answer than that. So I think we had one more question.
So I just want to know, how do you ensure
You are able to hear.
You could use it. I'm actually surprised to know that customers are not aware. So that's I think that situation is gone. I think today customers do understand the security is very important with the breaches.
Understanding that security is important and that actually making an action, right, is totally different things. You know, when the, you know, rubber hits the road is something you have totally different experience, because then you are really tested, right? So to answer your question, right, very honest, in terms of the first thing what I get is, do you guys do pen test? Told you that, right? And I will be very honest in the sense that few of the CISOs or these security leaders are more open to hear new thoughts. But I think it's sort of, I hate it. And if you look at my profile, I always try to work against that. But I think a couple of points which triggers that response of, yes, they have to change is, one is the FUD. The fear, uncertainty, doubt. I know it's a negative way of sort of doing it, but it works. It still works. Second thing is, just map it to what their fellow CISO or CIO is doing. You tell him that this CISO, Anand, any of this is doing this, and I think you should be looking at it. Works. It does wonders in terms of selling. So at least as from a selling point of view, it works. FUD and comparison with what their peers are doing, I think that works. But still, you know, I would still slightly disagree. People say they want security, but, you know, they don't want to make investment, or they would want something which is like a 50 crore staff. They would want it in sort of 1 crore. So it is literally to that, and you get peanuts. I mean, that's a different thing. But yeah, that's how we handle it, at least as a service provider.
Wonderful. I think it was very wonderful discussion. Thank you so much, panelists, for sharing your ideas. I'm sorry we cannot go ahead with more questions. I think we have the next team here already waiting to take the dais. Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you.